So let me introduce myself. So I am Ranjit Ram. So I'm having a 3+ years of experience in CAE. So currently I'm work with Hinduja Tech Groups, so which is a part of Ashok Leyland. So occasionally we provide trainings for the students as well as the industrial professionals. In some cases, we also provide trainings to the corporate also. Okay. So regarding this course, it's a 13-day session. So what you get from this course is you had a brief introduction to the answers, and the objective of the course is once you completed that thing, you'll be able to do a simple analysis. Not a simple one. You can also do a intermediate level of analysis in answers also. So it will be a strong foundation for you guys, those who are enrolled in the CAE domain also. Okay. And I'll start with the FAA. We already see some of the glitch which is regarding to the FAA yesterday itself also. So the introduction to the FAA. So we all know that the FAA, finite element analysis, is one type of numerical method. So we have four different types of numerical method, but the workbench is totally belongs to the finite element analysis. So what it does is basically it split the model into a small pieces, like using the discretization process. So if you have a irregular area surface like this, want to find the area, you don't have any direct formula to calculate that thing. In such situation, what you can do is you can discretize the model into a small pieces. Right now I'm having elements here, the element number 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and 5. So we call it as an element. Okay. So what is its use? So this is what we discussed yesterday. So we do the calculation on the limited domains. Okay, because it is impossible to do the calculation on an infinite region. So that is why we just convert the infinite region to a finite region through discretization process. And once you discretize this thing, you have so many elements, you try to apply the calculation on each and every element and get some results, and add upon all the results, you'll get the cumulative areas. Okay, as simple as that. And it is for the 2D case because it only has a values in X and Y. So apart from that, we don't have any values on the Z also. Okay, fine. We can't see your screen, sir. Right, I'll share my. Now is it visible? I hope is it visible. Yes. Okay. So basically the slides. So we have a regular shape like this, and then we just convert that infinite to a finite regions through meshing. So usually in answers we said like this is meshing. Okay. Once you're done with the meshing, you can move on to the next thing. Like right now vZine is a 2D one. It's a 2D model. So when we talk about the 3D, so in real time, the most of the objects we have is a 3D one. So especially the 3D models is meshed with the help of 3D elements. Basically, the elements can be classified as a three major categories, like 1D elements, 2D elements, and 3D elements. I'll explain why we had a search class, I mean classification. So why can't we directly go for 3D? Because all the real-time objects is comes under the 3D, right? Instead of going with the 3D, why we need this separations like 1D and 2D and 3D? So we'll discuss. So in this slide, what they asking, they're asking two questions: what is nodes and elements, and what are the types of elements? See, for the past 2 days, we only discuss about the theoretical sessions. We are not get into the software because for the answers, you may be some of you peoples, you already enrolled in a course like a CAD softwares or something like that. It's entirely different from a CAD software. For CAD software, it is not mandatory you should be an engineering student. Even though peoples who comes from the arts background or from a BA background who are interested in the designing, They can just come to the design software, enrolled in a design software, and learn the basic tools. What are the tools? Like Xtool, Revol, and the basic sketching. They can easily do any modeling. Okay. But what happened in the analysis part is, especially we talk about ANSYS or ANSYS CFD, it's not about the designing thing, it's all about the engineering stuffs. So only the engineer can learn that software. Because when you want to do the thermal analysis, you should be well aware of the subject like HMT, heat and mass transfer, and you should be very strong in the fluid dynamics also. And when you are interested to do the structural analysis, you should be very strong in the strength of material. So all the things will need the engineering help. So without that theoretical knowledge, nothing has happened in the ANSYS. So that is why we always give a more importance to the theoretical part. So just try to understand it. Probably if you are going for any interviews, that recruiter will ask these questions also, like what is notes and elements, because these are all the fundamentals of the sessions. Okay. So notes and elements plays a major role in any analysis. So for example, I'll just say that we just convert this infinite region to a finite region through discretization or meshing. We just convert it as a elements. So this is one element. So this closed loop is considered as an element. Okay, one more person. Okay. So to create any elements, obviously we need the help of nodes. So the nodes is nothing but it's a junction point of one element to another element. So if you have a four sides, you will have a node at four each corners, like this corner points. So why I say that it's a junction point, because this two elements is connected with each other, right? So here, 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 it's connected with each other. So that is why I'm just saying that it's a junction point of elements. Always we can say it as a nodes as calculation point also. That is also possible. So nodes, it's like a calculation point. You'll understand that point why I'll say that nodes is like a calculation point. You can just assume that a nodes as a sensing point. If you have a more number of nodes in your component, like a fine mesh, if you try to do a fine mesh, right now it's a coarse mesh. If you try to do a fine mesh in your component, probably you'll have a more number of nodes. Okay. So the more number of nodes, the more number of accuracy, but simultaneously the problem solving procedure, I mean the problem solving time is also much more higher. So I say that, sir, what is the reason the calculation time is so higher when we try to create a higher number of nodes? So this is what happened. So first, according to the procedure of FEA, in FEA there is a series of steps. FEA follows the steps while solving the problem. So first, what it does is it just creates a stiffness matrix. Okay, so if you are having this subject in your engineering, probably you'll just aware of this what I'm trying to say here. So first, it try to create a stiffness matrix for your problem. What is the size of the stiffness matrix? Is it's according to your node counts. Suppose if in your problem, if you are having 100 nodes, it always creates 100 cross 100 nodes. So suppose if you have a 200 nodes, a 200 cross 200 matrix will be created. So the more number of nodes, the bigger size of the stiffness matrix. Okay. Once it's defines or created the stiffness matrix, it will try to solve that matrix. Okay. To solve the matrix, first it will try to convert that stiffness matrix into a simultaneous equation. Or else you can say it as a algebraic equations. So once it is done, it calculates for the unknown variables. So this process involves, because if the matrix size is much more higher, the solving time will be much more higher. So this is the basic principle. So that is why we always recommend that when you try to discretize the model, like meshing of the model, always use a coarse mesh, not a fine mesh. because if you use a fine mesh, you have a lot and lot of nodes and elements that obviously increases your what we say, the analysis time. So although you'll get a better mesh on finer, I mean better results on the finite mesh, so while considering the time factor, that's not a big deal. Okay, so we have to solve the problem as simple as possible. Good. So then you'll have a clear idea regarding the nodes and elements. The elements is the closed areas. If you have a four sides, we call it as a quad element. If you have a three sides, we call it as a triangular element. What about the node? A node is the calculation point, as well as we can say it as a junction point, or else a, the corner points of the elements. So without nodes, you can't create any elements at all. And what are the types of elements? This is very, very important question. So you have to ask yourself, what is the types of the elements? I'll say that we have three types. In overall, in ANSYS itself, we have three different types of analysis. What is the three different types of analysis? Like 1D, 2D, and 3D. Okay. So it's 1D and 2D and 3D. Actually, when we talk about, can anyone explain what is 1D and 2D and 3D? What is the difference between? I mean, not only the explanation, I'm asking about the real-time example. So you don't need to give an explanation about, like, this is 1D and 2D and 3D. And you can give any example, okay, a real-time example, not just a line or like that thing. So this component is belongs to 1D, and this is 2D, and this is 3D. Can anyone? I think you have a 23 people over here. I'll choose randomly. Sai, Jishwant, and bachelor's food. Sai Kumar, Ishwant, Ranjit. My same name, Ranjit Reddy. Can anyone just unmute yourself and just talk so nobody has to? So if you ask more questions, you'll get a more knowledge from me. Yes, who's first?
So 1D means it's an front view of an object, like when you see with our eye.
Okay.
You can see the front face of the object is little bit like a 1D. If you goes to 3D view means 3-dimensional, you can see the side view and the right view and the front view. It's little bit like a complete whole object you can see, sir, like while rotating. It's an 3D one.
Okay. Yeah, is exactly correct, but you see that perspective with respect to the drafting, like a CAD modeling perspective. But basic.
Yes,
yeah, basically, the 1D means they denotes that it has only one dimensions at all. Okay, so when we talk about, so this classifications is comes under the this part. Like when I try to draw a coordinate system, I'll just name it as X. This is Y, and this is gonna be X, and this is gonna be Z. Ideally, if I try to draw one line, okay, one line in x-axis. So this line is a 1D because it only has a dimension in the what we say in x-axis. Might be it has a dimension of around 10 centimeter or anything like that. Once again. So since it has only one dimension, I'll say it's a 1D. But if I try to draw a rectangle, I'll have a two dimensions. That is X dimension and Y dimension. Probably I don't have any Z dimensions at all. So I can say that it's a 2D. So what happened if I have a cube? It's a cube one. So I have a three dimensions over here, like x and y as well as a z. So I can call it as a 3D. But it's just an illustrative purpose. But when you try to assume any real-time component, so like we don't have a line as a real-time component. We don't have a square as a real-time component. But we have a cube as a real-time component. Okay. So when I say the example for the 3D, we have that available product. So even though if you choose the 1D component as a thread, most of the people say is when I try to ask this question, they simply say that like, sir, thread is a best example for 1D. Yeah, you're correct. But even though the thread has some thickness, okay, so variable thickness like 1 mm thickness or 2 mm thickness or that, so that indicates the y dimension and z dimension. Okay, so even though if you choose for the 2D example like a paper, the paper has some thickness at all. Okay, it doesn't have some thickness. No paper should has without zero thickness. Even you choose any a minimum paper or a cardboard, it has some thickness, 1 mm or 2 mm thickness. Okay, so ideally when we think about this modeling process, no real-time component is matches with the condition of 1D and 2D. A 1D and 2D is just an assumption case. Okay, so why we included in this analysis is to make the analysis process more smoother. So that is why we need the analysis of 1D and 2D. So ideally you can directly import any component and do the 3D analysis in ANSYS itself. Okay, so but in which cases I can go with 1D and 2D, and 3D is very, very important. So for that, ANSYS has a rules that when you choose any component, the one dimension is too large while comparing to the other two dimension. So in such situation, you can go with the 1D analysis. So I'll explain what is the meaning of this point. So let me draw a coordinate system like this. This is X. Okay, I'll mark this is Y, and this is X, and this is Z. Okay. So I'll just take it a pen as an example. When I place the pen over here, so probably the length of the pen maybe around 15 centimeter. When I try to measure the cross section, it only has a dimension of around 0.5 mm or 0.5 centimeter some cases. So when comparing these two factors, in X it has a 15 centimeter, but in Y and Z it only has a 0.5 centimeter. So you can just compare these two values. It's very, very minimum, these two values. Then the one dimension, I mean the one dimension is too large while comparing to the other two dimension. Then we can simply go for the 1D analysis for this pen. Okay, so ideally we don't need design the whole component. So instead of designing this whole component, I'll just design a line segment. It's a line body, and try to assign the cross section as an additional data. So for the 1D analysis, it asks you for additional data, that is cross section. So what type of cross section it is? Because ideally you can't say that by just looking a line segment, it's a circular one or a isectional one. Just a line segment, it may have any cross section. So for this pen, it has a circular cross section. If it is a bar, maybe it has a rectangular cross section or a square cross section or even I section and C section also. So this kind of cross section you can assign to a line body. So basically, if you assign the cross section as an additional data, this analysis is called 1D analysis. So in our course, we have 1D analysis, 2D analysis, and 3D analysis also. And what about the 2D? So the 2D means the two dimension is too large while comparing to the third dimension. Okay, like just take it as a cardboard as an example. In the cardboard, it has a X dimension, it's around 20 centimeter, and Y dimension, it's around 25 centimeter. But when you try to measure the thickness, maybe it has 0.2 centimeter. Okay, or 20 mm maybe. So while comparing to those two values like 20 centimeter and 25 centimeter, so 0.2 centimeter is very, very minimum. So in such situation, I can go with 2D analysis. So most of the surfaces are analyzed with respect to the 2D analysis. Okay, so then in 2D, you only have a two dimensions. One is X and one is Y. You don't have any thickness at all. You have to give the thickness as an additional data. So just what we do in 1D, so we just model the line body as a 1D one, and we try to assign the cross section like circular and then this bar, I section as an additional data. Similarly, we model the component with respect to surfaces. Initially, it is having a zero thickness for an illustrative purpose. And laterally, we assign the thickness, maybe 5 mm or 10 mm as an additional input. When we talk about the 3D, all the three dimensions are comparable with each other. So when we take a crankshaft or engine block, so this not comes under any part like 1D or 2D, because it belongs to like all the three dimensions in X axis, in Y axis and Z axis, neither be a too small or nor be a much bigger. Okay, it's all comparable with each other. So in such situation, you're not having the option to go with 1D or 2D. You have to just go with the 3D option. So that is the main thing. Okay, so for 3D, you'll already have a three dimension. In X axis also you'll have dimension, Y also having dimension, and Z also having dimension. So you don't need to assign any additional data. So the additional data is only needed for the 1D analysis as well as a 2D analysis itself. And hope you'll get this point. So now we get into the what are the types of elements we have here. Okay, so I'll just click over here. So there's a various examples for the various types of elements. I said the same story is written over here. Based upon the analysis, when you are trying to do the 1D analysis, you have to use the 1D elements to discretize the model. Because in 1D, I'll say that you'll only have a line body. So you can't use a 2D element to discretize this thing. You can only break the line segment by using line element. Ideally, if you have a surface, a planar surface, want to discretize this model, you can use a 2D elements. Either you can use a triangular shape to cut the model into a small pieces, or a quad elements, the second one, to make it as a convert that model into infinite to finite region through discretization. But when we talk about a 3D component like a cube, you can use a hexahedral or tetrahedral elements, as simple as that. Okay, let's detailedly study about what are the different types of elements. So these are all the names of elements. Okay, so the 1D element, we have two different categories, that is first order element and second order element. Don't look at for the second order element first. I'll explain to you first. Let me start with first order element. In 1D, we have line body. So how the line body is created, for each and every lines, there is a node at the starting point, at the ending point. This scenario, we call it as a 1D line body, 1D element, okay? So when we come to the 2D part, I have a triangular element and then quad element. So also I have one more configuration that is not included in this slide, that is right angle triad, okay? So ideally, for the triangle, I have a three nodes. For quad, I have four nodes. This is first order. Okay, when we come to the 3D part, I'll have so many elements, but I only included two elements over here, so which are used in our current project also. Like in our course, we're gonna study about the tetrahedral and then hexahedral also. Okay, so that what is hexahedral and tetrahedral? It just the name comes from the sides of these things. Like if I have a six sides, I'll say it's hex, and if I have a four sides, I'll say it's a tetrahedral. So the tetra element is very similar. It's all comes from the 2D man. So the 3D is always comes from the 2D. 2D is always comes from the this references. Like when I try to extrude the quad or hex in this direction, you'll get a hexahedral. For 3D, what happen if I try to extrude a triangle? This element, we call it as a penta element, since it has a five sides. So that is why I'm saying that it's a penta element. Also, you can say it as a prism. prism element. Okay. And what about the tetrahedral? How it's created? So initially at the base we have a triangular element. So in the perpendicular direction or a normal direction, I'll have a one node. I'll just connect this node with this three corner points. Okay. I'll get this thing. That is called tetrahedrals. Hexahedral. So basically we recommend to use the people's like tetrahedrals because it's very difficult to create. And I mean hexahedral is very difficult to create and tetrahedral is very easy to create, but the probability and then accuracy is very very lesser than tetrahedral, but you'll get a more accurate result on hexahedral. And what about this first order point and then second order point? That is also very important. So in first order you only have a two nodes. The only difference is you'll have a double the node in the second order. So for a first order, in second order I have an additional node. So in first order triangle I only have a three nodes, but in second order I'll have a six nodes. In first order quad I'll have a four nodes, but in second order I'll have a eight nodes. So why we need is I just increase the probability of accuracy. I'll tell you one point at the discretization parts. So when I try to explain the nodes and elements, when you have a more number of nodes, you'll have a more number of accuracy. So the nodes matters. So you can assume that nodes is a sensing point. If you have a more number of nodes nearby the resultant area, you'll get a more number of accuracy. As simple as that. Okay. Also, it gives a more flexibility to your model. That is also a main factor. And hexahedral and then tetrahedrals, the same scenarios. So it's second order and then it's second order tetrahedrals. So the 4-node tetrahedrals and 10-node tetrahedrals, you can easily observe this scenario. Like it's more stiffer, it is more flexible because we have an additional node over here. So that is why it is very flexible. So when you try to mesh the component, like it is in a irregular shapes, having a more number of curves and filleted areas, holes, like that thing. Instead of going with the 4-node tetrahedrals, you can go with the 10-node tetrahedral. It will accurately capture all the areas. So that is what. So here I'll say that it's prism, or else in ANSYS we say it as a weed element. Weed. Okay. So it's for 6 nodes and 6. This is for the 15 node prisms. That seems. And 8 node tetrahedral, 20 nodes hexahedral. I mean 8 node hexahedron, 20 nodes hexahedron. So these are all the types of elements. And so after this, we have completed the what we say, nodes and elements, and what are the types of elements, like that thing. And I'll move on to the next part, that is what is degrees of freedom. Okay, this is very very important because the people who don't understand the degrees of freedom, you can't do anything inside the ANSYS because you need to create a lot of supports, like a fixed support, simply supported load, roller support, these things. So how this conditions is achieved is based upon the degrees of freedom. So what it says, the minimum number of parameters, the motion or coordinates and temperature required to define the position of any entities completely in the space is known as the degrees of freedom. So in simple words, if you have any point or a phase or any object, so you have to define the motion of that component. Basically I have a 6 degrees of freedom. Six DOFs we have. So in the 6 degree of freedom, the first three is we denote as a transnational. translation. Along x, y, and z. So the another thing is rotational. Rotational about x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. Okay, why this condition is very important? Let's when I just draw the coordinate system. So we know that this is y, and this is z. Obviously, this is x. What the scenario is explains. So when I have a point over here, if I try to free the translation freedom, like x-axis, y-axis, z-axis, this point can easily move on x-axis, can move on y-axis, can move on z-axis also. So what does it mean is it has a freedom to move along x-axis, along y-axis, along z-axis. Okay, because when you go to the get into the ANSYS analysis part, you have so many components. So when you try to fix any component, so probably you heard about this thing like fixed support. I'll just take a beam as an example. If you fix this problem like this, you'll just mark like this. What does it mean? So at the both ends, I just apply the fixed support. That means this point cannot be moved on any direction. That is what fixed support means. In fixed support, all the 6 degrees of freedom is get locked. It cannot move on x-axis, it cannot move on y-axis, it cannot move on z-axis. And what about the rotation? So the rotation means if you free the x rotation about the x-axis, it can be rotate like this. It take the x-axis as a perpendicular axis and try to rotate that point. So the point can be rotated like this. Or else, what about the rotation about y-axis? It should be like this. About y-axis, and it's about z-axis, as simple as that. Okay, so this is what, but when I try to assume it as a fixed support, there won't be any translation or there won't be any rotation at all the 6 degrees of freedom is get locked. And ideally, I hope you get a better understanding regarding the degrees of freedom, because for ANSYS it's very easy to assign the boundary condition. Eventually, when you try to enroll in a Hypermesh or any other higher end software, so there you won't have any standard one. You have to use the like DOF concept to create your own supports. As simple as that. Okay, then. So we just see the degrees of freedom, and then we'll move on to the material classification. Okay, so why we need the knowledge of material is because when you try to do any analysis, obviously you need the help of the materials. These are all already covered in your topic, that is you have the subject called strength of material, right? So in the strength of material, probably you heard about these terms. What are the general classifications of materials? We have three major categories. One is isotropic material, and another one is orthotropic material, and the last one is anisotropic material. Okay, what is the difference between those things? So first, let me start with the isotropic. So the isotropic material properties are not depend upon the direction. So which means they have the same property in all direction. When you try to choose a steel as an example, when you try to measure the properties like Young's modulus and then Poisson ratios on any point at the front, at the back, at inside the volume, so the properties will remain constant. Although it may not constant, but it's an assumption case. So ideally, you only have a isotropic and orthotropic condition itself. In real time world, there won't be any isotropic materials, because for the calculation purpose, we just assume that the steels and this materials, or what we say, it's an isotropic material. This properties cannot be varies with respect to the direction or anything. Okay, so that is what the isotropic material it means. Because when you get an intern into the analysis, you'll have a different types of card images. Based upon the types of the material, you have to choose that thing. Suppose if you want to create isotropic material, the Young's modulus and then Poisson ratio, you need to define on a single direction, okay? Because a single value, it cannot vary with respect to the direction. So accordingly, you have to choose a desired card image. Then only you can have a only one value. So if you choose isotropic card images and try to create an anisotropic material, you can't, because you only have a two space to define the values, one for Young's modulus, one space for Young's modulus and one space for Poisson ratio. But when we talk about the anisotropic material, in each and every direction, like in x-axis, y-axis, z-axis, the properties can be changes rapidly. Okay, for Young's modulus itself, you have to define the Young's modulus in x-axis, Young's modulus in y-axis and z-axis. The three values for Young's modulus, the three values for Poisson ratios. Okay, hope you get my point, what I'm trying to explain here. So that is what the orthotropic material properties, it can be varies in the three mutually perpendicular direction. So the best example is wood. So when you cut a tree down, so you can view that thing like at the core side, it will be much more harder to penetrate. But from the outer side, you can easily penetrate anything like a steel or anything, you can easily, because the outer side is very, very less dense while comparing to the inner core. It has more strength. So that is what that is why we included the wood as a best example. And what about the anisotropic material? So the anisotropic material is a different kind of thing. It's not a natural material, because isotropic and what we say like orthotropic is comes under the natural one, like wood and then steel, these things. But orthotropic materials, we create a composite materials, right? It's like a layer by layer one. So at first layer, you'll have a carbon layer, and you'll have a binding material like a fevicol, and one more layer like a fiber, and other than you have a fevicol layer, and you are just, it's just like a play wood. Okay, what we do here is we just place the wood and gum, again wood and gum, like a plate. So this properties will entirely behaves differently. So that is why we categorize this kinds of things in a anisotropic materials. So the best example for this material is composite material. Okay, and we have the symbols and meanings. So we don't need to study right now, because when we get into the software, we'll try to explain, okay, what is the symbols means, like a dark question mark and then light question mark and tick and the refresh button, everything. Okay, so yep, I hope that current session is completed, because what we do, what we see today is we just discussed about the various kinds of things, like what is finite element analysis and why we use the finite element analysis, and also we discussed why we do the discretization process, what is nodes and elements, how the nodes plays a major role in the accuracy of the analysis, and also we discussed about what is stiffness matrix and how the FEAs works, the different kinds of material things, what are the types of elements, and this kinds of stuff. It's all the basics to the software. So it should be, if you are very strong with these things, it'll be very easy to get understand the concept and the answers itself also. Okay, so that is all for this session. Yep, so any other questions from your side, you can always ask and unmute yourself and try to ask your questions. So if you don't have any questions, you can leave the session.